This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
Al-Arabiya has learned that Islamic Revolution leader Ali Khamenei refused former reformist president Mohammad Khatami's letter to solve the crisis in the country. Meanwhile, after recognizing the result of the last election, reformist Mehdi Karoubi demanded fair and free elections. He confirmed that he won't compromise when it comes to the people's rights. Karoubi explained his position after recognizing the presidency of Ahmadinejad and said that he's been under a lot of pressure because of the shutdown of his newspapers, the closure of his offices, the imprisonment of his supporters, and finally the assassination attempt on his life. He noted that his statements have been distorted. Meanwhile, the chairman of the Expediency Discernment Council, Hashimi Rafsanjani, talked about a conspiracy waged against him by the hardliners from the Conservative Party, referring to statements made by the head of the Society of Qom Seminary Teachers, Ayatollah Mohammad Yazidi. In his statement, he said that Rafsanjani is moving away day after day from the supreme leader and the rule of law.
Well, it seems like a clarification or a correction of his position on Ahmadinejad as president of Iran. Reformist leader Mehdi Karoubi announced that he will not compromise the people's rights, nor will he withdraw his demand for those rights, regardless of the pressure he's under and the assassination attempt he's endured. During his meeting with leaders from reform parties and political elites, Karoubi explained his position after announcing his recognition of Ahmadinejad as president. He said that he's been under extreme pressure and it has even reached an assassination attempt. He also indicated that his statements and reform leader Mir Hossein Mousavi's statements have been distorted. However, he stressed that he will maintain his demand for the voice of the voters that was stolen during the elections. Karoubi affirmed that he will remain by the people's side and will attempt to demand new, fair and free elections and the removal of the obstacles that are preventing them. Karoubi's talk came after indirect criticisms were made by Zahra Ranavard, the wife of reformist Mir Hossein Mousavi, by saying that Mousavi will not recognize President Ahmadinejad and that he does not consider his government to be legitimate and will not make any concessions behind closed doors. In the same context, deputy leader of the National Confidence Party, headed by Karoubi, Rasul Montajabnia, announced that the people of Iran will revolt against the reform leaders if they give up their right to reject the result of the election. Rasul Montajabnia also said that the Green Opposition Movement is not linked to Karoubi, Mousavi, and former President Mohammad Khatami. Karoubi's statements were placed by some within the context of providing information on the talks undertaken by Chairman of the Assembly of Experts, Hashimi Rafsanjani, with leader Ayatollah Ali Hosseini Khamenei. From his side, Khamenei said that the United States and Israel still remain Iran's greatest enemies, stemming back 30 years, and noted that attaching hope to enemies is a gross mistake. Khamenei added, as if warning reformists to mobilize, that when there is an error, it should be rectified. Najib Muhammad Ali, Al-Arabiya. Al-Arabiya.
An international conference is underway in London to discuss ways to help restore stability in Yemen.
وقد وصلت وزيرة الخارجية الأمريكية هيلاري كلينتون للمشاركة في الاجتماع.
U.S. Secretary of State Hillary Clinton arrived in London for the conference, which includes delegations from the Gulf Cooperation Council, the G8 Forum, as well as Arab and Western countries. Representatives from the EU, the UN, and international financial institutions are also in attendance.
وقد جاء في مسودة بيان سيصدر.
According to a draft resolution received by Reuters, Yemen is facing growing challenges which are threatening its stability and that of the region.
The resolution added that the Yemeni government is in dire need of assistance in order to carry out political and economic reforms. Meanwhile, Western countries reiterated their commitment to supporting Yemen in its war against al-Qaeda.
There's a growing debate among Yemenis on whether the London conference will be able to help the Yemeni government overcome its crisis.
Our correspondent in Sana'a, Murad Hashim, gathers Yemeni reactions.
From the womb of the war against al-Qaeda in Yemen, the London conference was born. The conference is a joint British-American effort held without prior consultation with the government of Yemen. This news comes after al-Qaeda in Yemen started to shift its operations outside the country, notably in the U.S. Information is still sketchy about the London conference in terms of agenda and participants. The Yemeni government, as a member of the so-called War on Terror campaign, is attending the conference. The Yemeni government prepared a long list of its achievements in the War on Terror, which includes its campaign of killing, pursuing, and capturing terrorist suspects. In return, Yemen is seeking financial and economic assistance to help it win the War on Terror.
Since the September 11th attacks, Yemen has paid a hefty toll due to its efforts, which aim to maintain stability and uproot terror cells and extremists. This was conducted at the expense of development.
The Yemeni government, which is attending the London conference, reiterated its opposition to any foreign intervention in the country. The Yemeni position has received wide-scale support from Egypt as well as from the various Yemeni constituents, which include Yemeni religious scholars and tribal leaders in Sana'a, supporters of the ruling party in Aden, Damashika tribes, and Al-Shabwan clans in Marib. On the other hand, Yemeni opposition groups sent the London conference mixed messages. The Southern Movement stepped up its efforts by staging rallies, sit-in strikes, and protests. Meanwhile, the Houthis have ended their war against Saudi Arabia. The Yemeni joint meeting parties have expressed their position in a letter that was handed to the British ambassador in Sana'a.
Just by letting the Yemeni authority attend this conference, it will make it more vulnerable. I believe that the role of the opposition should be practical.
In a previous conference, which was held by the civic society organizations, the participants concluded that the Yemeni problem is political and needs a political solution, which will help end the security deterioration fueled by al-Qaeda. Many inside and outside Yemen agree.
If the international community is inept in helping Yemen and its people overcome their crisis, then the international community must refrain from making it worse. They must help the Yemeni people achieve political stability.
The conference, which was not attended by the Yemeni president, has caused division among the delegations from the start, perhaps because many perceive it as the last resort to ending the crisis. Murad Hashim, Al Jazeera, Sana'a.
As the world prepares to commemorate International Holocaust Remembrance Day tomorrow, Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu landed in Poland as President Shimon Peres continues his state visit in Germany by meeting with the German president and taking part in official ceremonies. IBA's Brian Freeman reports.
President Shimon Peres is in Berlin today, meeting with a number of top German officials on the Iranian nuclear threat and efforts to restart the peace process, while also attending ceremonies to commemorate the Holocaust. Peres held discussions with German President Horst Kohler and at this hour is in talks with Chancellor Angela Merkel. Peres also attended a ceremony at the train station platform 17, from where thousands of Jews were sent to their deaths. Last night, the president was hosted by the German Jewish community at a Berlin synagogue at the start of his three-day visit. A choir of Jewish youth performed for him, and Peres said it was very moving to be in Germany for Holocaust Remembrance Day. Tomorrow, Peres will give a speech in Hebrew at the Bundestag. Meanwhile, in Poland, Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu laid a wreath at the memorial to the Warsaw Ghetto on a day mostly dedicated to discussions with top Polish officials about regional and bilateral issues. Netanyahu met with Poland's foreign minister and then visited the spot where Nazis in 1942 loaded about 320,000 Jews from the Warsaw Ghetto into cattle cars and sent them to their deaths at Treblinka. Brian Freeman, IBA News.
Israel's failure to negotiate a peace deal with the Palestinians is a greater threat to the country than a nuclear Iran. That's the view of Defense Minister Ehud Barak, who told a Tel Aviv gathering that the lack of a recognized national border, including a clear Jewish majority within and a Palestinian majority outside, is the most serious threat to Israel's future. Addressing Iran's disputed nuclear program, Barak said that Tehran is using international dialogue to play for time while producing nuclear weapons. The defense minister called for negotiations to be limited to a short time frame, as well as the simultaneous imposition of harsh and paralyzing sanctions. Relating to a possible Israeli military strike against the Shiite Republic, Barak repeated that all options are on the table and none have been canceled. Turning to Lebanon, Barak said that Resolution 1701 failed to end the threat in the north and that Hezbollah rockets and missiles can reach virtually all of Israel. Barak praised the Egyptians for starting construction on a security wall on its Gaza border, but warned that Hamas terrorists now have rockets capable of striking Tel Aviv.
بعد مرور عام على الحرب وتحت أنقاض منزل مهدم شمال قطاع.
One year after the war ended, the rifle and some personal belongings of a Zionist soldier were found under the rubble of a destroyed home in northern Gaza. More details with our reporter Bassam Albatta.
الحكاية بدأت قبل عام.
The story started 1 year ago in Al Salam neighborhood in eastern Jabalia. Muhammad Bashir Khadr, a mujahid from the Al-Aqsa Brigades, waited for an infantry Zionist unit in a home along the border. He managed to kill one Zionist soldier, drag his body into a home and fortify himself in it.
On the
10th day of the Gaza war, he called his brothers, I mean his leaders, and told them that he killed an Israeli soldier and took his Katsar M16 rifle and hid it in a safe location. The leaders told him that it would be great if they were to move the body of the soldier.
Immediately, the occupation planes rushed the scene and bombed the house with everything inside. They wanted to make sure that the resistance did not have another soldier hostage like Gilad Shalit. Muhammad's body was found by his comrades in the destroyed house, along with some of the Zionist soldiers' body parts. But his rifle was never found.
We found the soldier's helmet and military uniform in pieces. We also found his foot and other body parts. The enemy collected some of the soldier's body parts, but because they wanted to withdraw quickly, they left some behind.
The hope of finding the rifle of the Zionist soldier was lost, but Muhammad's sister Iman saw him in her dream. He told her about the location of the weapon.
When he came into my dream, he told me that the rifle is under a bed.
حكالي تحت تيك تخت موجود ولا تحت تيك
He told me that when I will look for it, I will find it under the place he told me about. It is under something like a bed.
Muhammad departed, but his sister Iman managed to find the weapon. It was entrusted in the hands of his young son. It's a message from those who left to those who stayed alive. Only God knows how many bullets went out of this American-made rifle and ended up in the hearts of women, children, and old people. Today, thanks to Muhammad's pure hands, this rifle ended up in the hands of the Palestinian resistance, and it will be used in the battlefield again. This time, however, it will be aimed at the chests of the sons of Israel. Bassam Al-Batta, Al-Aqsa Satellite Channel, Gaza.
غزة. تعيش البلدة القديمة في الخليل حالة من التوتر بسبب الاحتكاكات.
The daily friction between Jewish settlers and Israeli soldiers on one hand and Palestinian citizens on the other is causing tension in the old town of Hebron. However, a group of American Christian volunteers who live in the city are trying to separate the two sides and calm the situation. Our correspondent Ahmed Al-Buderi met with the group and brought us this report.
The tensest place in the West Bank is the Old Town in Hebron. For years, the town has been semi-empty, and the harassment by the settlers and the patrols of the Israeli army have turned the hostilities into a daily occurrence. Amidst the tension, a group of foreigners wearing red hats roam the city to protect its residents. Some of them came from the United States. Every day, they meet in front of the Tomb of the Patriarchs.
So we stand most mornings on school days.
We stand most mornings on school days to make sure that school children are exercising their right to pass through. Frequently, their backpacks get searched and they get harassed by Israeli soldiers. They're simply children who are going to school.
This soldier was disapproving of our presence, but American citizen Drew confirmed that this nuisance is nothing in comparison to what the residents of the city have to live with. The narrow alleys of the old town are unsafe. Orthodox settlers throw stones and garbage on the passers-by. This coffee shop is a meeting place for the activists and residents who inform them of the harassment and acts of aggression that take place.
Through their prevention of the soldiers' harassment, they help a lot in reviving the old town. When the army sees foreigners, they get scared and don't act harshly with the citizens.
For the foreigners who live in Hebron, this modest house is where they operate by recording what happens and sending reports and photos of assaults. I wandered around the city of Hebron with Paulette, an American teacher from Ohio. She's been here for a year, and it seems like she's no stranger to the city of Hebron. She knows many residents and is aware of the details of what is going on. Some women have intended to stay in the old town and not leave it. More than two-thirds of the residents left, and Paulette is trying to ease the concerns of those who remain.
I feel that they have a problem with our government.
I feel that they have a problem with our government, but they have hope in Obama, even though he hasn't met their needs. I don't feel any hatred here because I'm an American. The Palestinians like the Americans, but not our government.
They like the Americans, but not our government.
The settlers control some homes inside the old town, and for years, some of them have been attacking Palestinians, while the Israeli army occasionally tries to intervene between the two parties by breaking up gatherings and closing some alleys and corridors. Ahmed Al-Buderi, BBC, from the old city in Hebron.
Afghanistan's former foreign minister Abdullah Abdullah has said his country is not ready to set a date for withdrawal of foreign troops. He made the comments on the sidelines of the World Economic Forum in Davos ahead of a conference tomorrow in London where Afghan President Hamid Karzai and Western countries will decide their future strategy in the country. Abdullah also said that while conditions were difficult in Afghanistan, the prospect is not so bad despite what he called the failure of President Karzai's government.
Unfortunately, the situation has not reached to a stage that we could say that we can let the troops leave. Yeah, that's not the case. But we do need troops at this stage, the presence, but at the same time, the focus on the civilian life as well as on strengthening security institutions could facilitate for that purpose. So, giving the time is difficult, but at the moment, the partner that you are relying or the international community is relying is failing in its own mission. I mean the Afghan side, unfortunately, the current leadership, the current administration. With this, the prospect is not so bright.
It seems that banning Islamic traditions in European countries has become an acceptable practice. After banning mosque minarets in Switzerland, a French parliamentary committee has introduced a new bill calling for the ban of the Muslim niqab and burqa in all public places and institutions. If adopted, the measure, which also applies to visitors, is expected to pass due to the overwhelming support in the parliament. Our correspondent, Mohamed Wamusi, reports from Paris.
The French parliament, backed by the right-wing majority, has stepped up its efforts to ban the Muslim burqa in France. A parliamentary committee formed by French President Nicolas Sarkozy and led by the chair of his ruling party called for the ban on the Muslim niqab and burqa in all public places.
Because it's not a religious garment, we had no choice but to make a definite decision. If the extremists want to mobilize, they will mobilize anyway. Our task was to draft legislation to uphold our principles. We are not profiling any religious or immigrant groups. It's not a religious problem. This is an issue of security and respect for women.
The new law, which also applies to visitors and tourists, is expected to take effect in the next few days.
Tourists are always welcome in France. However, they must respect our laws as we respect theirs. This is normal.
The opposition, led by the Socialist Party, which fundamentally opposes the burqa, has rejected the new law and called for its postponement. The opposition called for extending the debate on the new law, but stirred doubt that it will be implemented.
The issue of the burqa is very complicated and limited because it only affects a few hundred women. We must stop creating large problems in our society. The problem can't be resolved by drafting a new law. We must hold a dialogue with these women and respect their beliefs.
The new French law doesn't distinguish between those living in France and those visiting for tourism or medical treatment. This means that a large number of tourists, especially from the Arabian Gulf, must reconsider their travel arrangements, if only to avoid being harassed or fined by the French police. Mohamed Wemoussi, Dubai TV, in front of the French Parliament, Paris.
The town of Hanawi held the first funeral for victim Hassan Tajuddin of the crashed Ethiopian plane during an official and local memorial. Minister Ali Abdullah, representing the three leaders of the country, Representatives Abdul Majid Salah, Hani Qureshi, and Nawaf Al Musawi, and Southern Hezbollah official Sheikh Nabil Qawuq attended the funeral. The funeral procession started from the home of the deceased. The garland decorated casket was carried to the town cemetery, where Sheikh Qawuq held a prayer service for the spirit of the victim to rest in peace.
In the town of Al-Abbasiyah, in the Suryerf region, families of the missing people are receiving condolences while waiting to hear good news of their children being among the survivors.
I love him a lot. I hope he comes back to us, oh Lord.
More than 36 hours have passed since the catastrophe of the Ethiopian plane crash, but the families of four passengers from the town of Al-Abbasiyah still insist that their relatives are only missing, that they are still alive, and hope that they will be found.
We still have not recovered the body.
Some of us think they're missing in hopes that they are among the survivors, God willing.
منازل ذوي المفقودين الأربعة طبيب العيون تنال فردون.
The homes of the four missing people, optometrist Tanal Fardoun, Khalil Saleh, Abbas Hawili, and Mohamed Bazouni, are filled with visitors from the neighborhood inquiring about the result of the search and rescue efforts. If some managed to contain themselves and control their tears, the mothers, wives, and daughters of the missing were overcome by sadness and silence. They stayed at home, carrying pictures of their loved ones, waiting for good news that might end the most miserable day of their lives.
The city of Nabatiya had the largest number of victims from the air crash. What's the situation like a day after the disaster? Rafat Al-Ayim has the report.
A day after the disaster, the families of the air crash victims from the city of Nabatiya are still in shock. 12 Nabatiya natives are missing. Sadness and despair overwhelm the entire city that turned somber while its shops and institutions closed. Here in the home of missing person Ali Ahmed Jaber from Nabatiya, his wife and mother demand to know what happened to him and ask for his body to be sent home. They are surrounded by women who came to comfort them and offer their condolences.
We just hope they move the rescue operation faster than this.
What am I supposed to say? He's my sunshine. He would come comfort me all the time. He did everything to buy a piece of land to stay next to his mother.
The scene is the same in the house of two other missing people, Fuad and Abbas Jaber, but the sadness here is doubled. The shock is twice as strong for the family that may have lost both of them. In Zatar al-Sharqi, folks have come to Abdel Hussein Ismail's home for the second day to comfort the family for their son, Yasser.
We hope that he will come back, even if he's not alive. Of course, the body is dear to us. We don't want to completely lose him.
Akfar Tibnid has been waiting for news about her missing son, Hussein Hayek, in eager anticipation to hold him again. Her family is still in shock and everybody is overcome with pain. The families of the victims only want one thing, to recover the bodies from the sea and to have them released to the families. In their last journey, may they receive a goodbye worthy of their loved ones, whose destiny changed their initial path and determined their fate.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic video podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you. This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.